I'm Mark Kepler with Purdue University Extension Service, and I'm going to take an opportunity today to talk about a couple of things. And one of the things I want to talk about is invasive species. And we talk about how things have come to the United States and to the North American continent from other locations throughout the world, and how some of our native things have been pushed out of the way by these invasive species that come in. There's a lot of species that have been brought to this country that aren't native. And one of the things I bring up right off the bat are things like cats, dogs, cattle, pigs. These are things that are not native to this continent that have been brought in, and we've been able to domesticate them and utilize them to our best of our advantages. But reality is, too, there are other things that have come in here that have spread and caused some problems. And one of those things is right behind me in this pond area, and it's a weed we call Phragmites. Now, most of us don't even realize it's out there and it exists. And that's because of the fact we have, native to our country, something we have called common reed. And this is very much identical to common reed. In fact, they are the same species, but this I would look at as just a different variety. It's kind of like looking at an apple tree, and you have apple trees, but you have different varieties. You may have a Granny Smith or a Jonathan. Well, in this situation, this common reed has a European variety that has come into our country, and this European variety is one that's very aggressive, especially in our wetland areas. And so we're standing out here right next to a location right off the road from Olson Road here, and we're taking a look at some ponds that have this weed starting to grow up around it. Most people don't even realize it's happening, and then all of a sudden they start seeing it out here. And this is Phragmites. And Phragmites, what it does is it grows from rhizomes or tuberous roots underground, and it comes up and it starts growing, and it gets to be, oh, probably around 12 foot tall. It can even get that 10 to 12 foot tall. And it dies down in the wintertime, then it comes back up in the springtime. And what it ends up doing is growing in this area, and it'll eventually encircle a wetland area. So like in this pond situation, it's not going to get out into the pond, but if we have an area that's a wetland where it stays wet part of the time and part of the time it's dry, Phragmites can take over that wetland area. In the process of taking over that wetland area, it shoves out all the native vegetation. It's extremely effective in that, and because you can see the thickness that this plant has. And by shoving out all that native vegetation, it also shoves out some of the potential animals that might be utilizing that native vegetation to exist and to live. And that's one of the biggest problems with invasive species. Not only do we lose out where they come in, and they shove out other things that we're really worried about in our area, and we lose our native products. Now, one of the things that we have talked about in our area and wetlands is something called purple loosestrife. Beautiful flower comes up, it's purple in color, and it has come into our wetlands and started shoving things out. Well, as you can see, this Phragmites is even more effective at doing that, and the fact is it can shove out purple loosestrife, and it causes a tremendous amount of problems in our wetland areas. Well, what I've done is I've went and dug up a little bit of this Phragmites around this area, and one of the things it has is it has root systems that are very, very thick and very, very full. And what it does, it sends out little tubers we call rhizomes. So once a plant is established, these rhizomes go out and they push up another plant, and they go out and they push up another plant. And so by doing this, we end up having just a mat of these different vegetations around our area. And so this is just an example of the root system of this Phragmites. Now, in this location right behind me, the Phragmites has came out from this pond, and the water is stopping it from going into the pond. It's just too thick there. But out into this lawn, we have mowed it off, and there are small, very small Phragmites plants into this area. So even mowing this area cannot get rid of it. It is so aggressive and so effective, it really does a tremendous job of coming into there. So what's an advantage of having this invasive species around? Well, if you got wildlife like blackbirds, They like to use it. They like to be seen in it. And so the deer in wetland areas can be using it for shelter because they can use it in a location like that. One big advantage that people on a pond like this would see is we get Canada geese coming in. And Canada geese will fly in, land on the pond, and then if it's really nicely groomed around the pond, they'll walk off of that pond and they'll come up in the yard. And sometimes the population of Canada geese can be extremely thick, too thick. People don't want that many in their yards. So having this area like this, the Canada geese cannot get off the pond. They will not walk through that because they're scared that there could be something lurking in that that could try to eat them or kill them. And so because they are preyed upon, they are fearful of this area. So this pond would have a lower level of Canada geese around it. And that's really one of the advantages or disadvantages, depending on how you look at Canada geese. But the population can be tremendously thick, and that's what we can be looking at in these situations. So now let's talk about control. And we're going to try to figure out how to take care of this. I already said that mowing it off isn't going to do it. We can't mow it off. And obviously, what's out there in the water can't be mowed off. That's a tremendously hard job to do that. So I've got some of this plant in front of me right now. And I'm going to take a look at it. The leaves on Phragmites are very stiff and very slick, like a lot of other aquatic plants. And so one of our options for this is to spray it with a chemical. And the chemical that we would use on this contains the active ingredient called glyphosate. We all know glyphosate when we use it as a product called Roundup. But in an aquatic environment, we don't like to use Roundup, but we can use the active ingredient that's found in Roundup, and it will work. The problem with Roundup is it has some problems in aquatic areas, and the fact that, for one thing, it doesn't stick to this slick surface as well. Plus, the carriers in it will have some product problems with the fish and the wildlife. So because of that, we go to aquatic versions of Roundup. And they can be found locally in some of our stores in the sections that are required or the sections that are into aquatic plants. There's a lot of different aquatic weed killers, and we would use the aquatic version of Roundup with the active ingredient glyphosate in it. And so go to your local stores and ask for aquatic versions of Roundup. What we would do is we could spray that Roundup on there right now, and it really kills everything it comes in contact with. The great news about it is it has no soil activity. So it only kills green things that it comes in contact with, and other things can come back. Roundup translocates down into that plant, down into that root, and kills that root off. One application generally will not be enough. It'll take multiple applications before we can see it. So anytime, this time of year, we can do this the fall of the year before things start to turn brown, because what you're seeing in our background with the seed heads of this Phragmites is left over from last year, and that's the seed heads from last year. This year it's just a green plant coming up right now. So in the fall of the year, that is also very effective in killing, because at that time the translocation is really done extremely well into the plant, and so the kill is a lot better done in the fall of the year, say around October-ish, sometime around then. I just wanted to take an advance to take a look at the seed head on this. This is a seed head that was formed last year, and so we'll be seeing another new seed head coming on later on this year. And what has happened is this seed is fairly fluffy, and so it can be spread very easily by wildlife and also by the winds that we have, and so it does spread around. Once that seed hits the ground and starts to grow, we get a plant out of it. Then once that plant starts to come out the bottom with rhizomes, it really gets to form that thick mat around there. So this is a little bit about what we're looking at. In your community, there are a lot of different invasive species we're starting to see. Phragmites is just one of them, and really is being seen in those wetland areas. And so you may want to see it early when it initially comes in to try to take some control of it. That's the real key to invasive species, identifying this, seeing what it is, and trying to kill it out at a young age before it gets too big and too large on you. This is just an example of what it can do. But if we look at some of the wetland areas where the water doesn't stop it, it can really get in and just totally invade that wetland area, and we can have a tremendous change in the amount of species, both native and non-native, that comes into that area. And in general situations with invasive species like this, it's a bad situation, and you really need to think about what you can do to stop it on your own property. I'm Mark Kepler with Purdue University Extension Service here in Rochester and Fulton County, and I've been talking a lot lately to individuals and groups and to a lot of people about invasive species. And a lot of times these are species that come in from other countries that most of us don't really have a clue they're even around. And I'm here today besides another one of those that's in real full bloom right now this time of year. And this is one called Asian bush honeysuckle. An Asian bush honeysuckle is a plant that has been brought into this country because it is beautiful, white blooms, and because it smells, that honeysuckle smell to it, really has a nice odor to it. So people brought this plant into our country and they started planting in a variety of areas. Well, it's really taken off in growing every place. And what it starts off doing is it starts off growing along the edges of woods. We're along the edge of a woods right now, and you can see it here, and we'll show you more examples of it growing along the woods in different areas. And as we, the interesting thing about this plant is the fact that it can grow in the shade. So it can starts out here in the edge, and then it works its way into the woods. And as it works its way into the woods, again, the invasive nature of this plant shoves out everything else around there. In fact, all the little plants that we normally have growing in the woods, the trilliums, the jack in the pulpits, the spring beauties, the May apples, all those plants that we find out in our woods get pushed out of the way because of this Asian bush honeysuckle. In northern Indiana, we're just starting to see it really develop and get really increased populations around here. And as it increases in the populations, it'll go into that woods and it'll shove out those other things. In fact, it can be so bad that if we log out the woods, the Asian bush honeysuckle plant will come in before our native trees have a chance to regenerate them small little trees. So our oaks and our hickories and our trees that are starting to regrow, walnuts, won't have that opportunity because this one will beat it to its punch as they come into that center of it. What's interesting too about this plant is it is one of the first plants to green up in the spring of the year in your woods, and then in the fall, after everything else has lost its leaves, it'll still be very green. So it really has that potential to lengthen its season out, and that gives it an opportunity to really strengthen itself. So when the leaves of these other trees have fallen off, this guy's getting the sunlight and strengthening itself and coming along that area. So it's called Asian bush honeysuckle. And if you see this coming into your woods or in a wooded area, what you really, if it's a very small plant, it's very easy to pull up in the early spring of the year when the ground is really soft. I can actually go out there and pull it up. Once it gets this size, we're beyond that. What we have in our arsenal for a plant like this, I again would use a product like Roundup with the herbicide in it called glyphosate. The reason we could use that is in the fall of the year, after everything else loses its leaves, this will still be green. And Roundup only works on green tissue. It does not work on the bark. So if this is the only thing that's green out here, we can spray this plant and we can kill it back and it'll go down in the roots and work down the roots. We could cut this off, but it'll just re-sprout. We could cut this off and apply concentrated Roundup to the cut. That will work also. So this time of year, that's something we can do with that. But this is Asian bush honeysuckle, and we're seeing it everywhere up and down the roads of our community, and it's in full bloom right now, and you're going to have an opportunity, you can see it, what's going on. Now, one of the characteristics of this plant that you can tell is the fact that I'll break this one off. We have branches on here that sometimes we call alternate, and we have opposite. Well, this one has opposite branches. Usually where one branch comes out, there we go. Where one branch comes out, there's another one right opposite coming out like this. It doesn't necessarily always mean that case. So that one I just picked up there, several of these opposite ones coming out were broken off like that. But look it over really good and you can see like this one here. There's a little tiny one there coming opposite, but these are opposite. That's one of the very good ways of telling this. And then, of course, look at the flower this time of year. You'll see that white flower and with it in bloom, and that's that honeysuckle flower. It comes mostly in white in our area, but there are other colors besides that that we can find throughout our community. Okay, this is kind of an example of how you might want to see this bush honeysuckle growing in your wooded area. First off, this plant is fairly small right here, but it can get way over the top of my head. It can be dang near at 8 foot, 9 foot tall. You can get that tall. So it gets way up there. But here's one here, bush honeysuckle growing in this location. We come on down here. Here's another one growing right here. This is one that's getting it. And we can keep right on going down this area. Right back here is another one starting to grow up in this area and coming in through here. And so now that they've kind of got a foothold in this community, what they're going to end up doing is going to end up just getting bigger and bigger and wider and wider. And across the road from this location, there's some other ones growing too. So they're really starting to take a foothold in this location. You be on the lookout in your woods. I'm sure they're there. You go out in your wooded areas and you'll see it growing in there right now. The blooms are just the best way to see it. The fall of the year is another way to see it. It'll still be green at that time. Think about what you're going to do and how you're going to try to control this, because it's not a good situation for your woods. And I really encourage you to take a look and try to do something about it. This is Mark Kepler, Purdue Extension Service, Fulton County. Thank you. This is Mark Kepler with Purdue Extension Service. What we're going to be doing over the next several programs here is taking a look at how to develop a garden, a vegetable garden at your own house. Why are we out in the woods today? And that's the question we're going to answer as we go into this program. Because it's important to think about, as we develop a vegetable garden, a little bit of history. That's right, going back in the history of Indiana and going back to the time when the pioneers first came into this area. When the pioneers came into Indiana, 87% of the state was trees. Because 87% of the state was trees, they came in here, they started chopping trees down, and they started farming around it. And what those pioneers found in the soils that we have here is the fact that those soils were just great soils to produce crops, to produce vegetables, to have their families live and enjoy life in Indiana. And so we're going to start this thing off by talking about the woods and what people would find in the woods and what about the soils of Indiana were so great. By the way, by the time the pioneers came into here in the early 1800s, again, 87% trees. By the year 1900, they had this state down to only 8% trees. They were very, very efficient in what they were doing, and they realized that Indiana was a great place to grow crops and to raise a family. Indiana is also a great place to have a garden too. So let's talk about this soil that we're upon here. This soil was developed under a forced situation. That means there were thousands of years of trees. Let's go clear back to the Ice Age. Oh, a little over 10,000 years ago, that great big sheet of ice came in here and wiped out this whole area. And since that time, our soils have developed under that under a forced situation that slowly came back into here. The thing to understand about trees in a forest are, we always think about they're very, very deep rooted. And they do have some roots go down very deep. In fact, trees such as oak trees have those big old tap roots that kind of go down in the ground. But the vast majority of the roots of that tree are in the top foot of the ground. And so what's happened here for thousands of years is the leaves have fell off the trees and dropped to the soil. The roots have gone out from those trees. And as those trees rotted away, the roots send up little tiny little white hair roots. And those little white hair roots then recycle those leaves, or in other words, they use up those leaves and they break them down. At the same time, there were a variety of different insects in this area that were also degrading that soil. So in that top foot of the ground where those tree roots are at, those tree roots have been growing and then they die and they rot. And that rotted earth, that rotted soil, is something we call organic matter. That is the key to what I'm talking about today. And this is the key to growing a garden, and it is the key to having any kind of a growing enterprise when we deal with the soil, is the organic matter, that rotted area that's down into the soil. And so that's what we had. By the way, just kind of a sidelight, when those pioneers came in here and they came into that woods, it wasn't looking kind of like the one we have here today. It was great big huge trees and it was very fluffy. The soil was very fluffy. And the reason it was very fluffy is because there weren't earthworms at that time. When those big old massive sheets of ice came through in that glacier time, They took out those earthworms at the time too. And so we had very fluffy soil. What the pioneers brought with them was earthworms, and now today we see lots of night crawlers and a lot of different kind of earthworms in our soils. And they're really interesting because they add to our soils, because they go up, they get a bite, and they pull it down of that leaf mass, and they pull it down into the soil, and they recycle it down into the soil, and they bring it down into there. So it's a really neat thing that we're looking at. And so let's take a look at what some of this soil would look like. Well, I brought along with me a shovel. I wanted you to have a take a look at what these soils really looked like in a forest long before they came along and started plowing them up, and how much organic matter was in these soils. So I'm going to dig up a little bit of earth here, and we're going to bring it up, and we're going to take a look at it, and we're going to see what's here. First thing I'm going to take a look at on this soil is the fact that it's dark in color. That's what that organic matter does. That rotting, it goes away, brings in that darkness to our soil. So anytime you're looking at a soil that's lighter colored, it lacks of the organic matter. But the darkness here is what brings in our organic matter into this soil. The other thing about these soils were, when they develop under this situation, they aren't just pulverized dirt. They have a lot of structure to them. For example, you can break them away, and as you break them away, they fall into little things we call peds and clods. Everything breaks up and everything falls away in it. That's the nature of the soil. By having that soil that falls away and breaks up like that, our roots of our plants can penetrate down through the channels. Channels left by old roots that have died, channels left by earthworms that have got into it and have also died or developed it. And so our soils, it would really be nice when we get into our soils if we can maintain that structure we refer to in these soils, and the ability to hold together, and the ability to fall into little peds like we're looking at. Beautiful, beautiful soil when we get into a forest situation. So this soil has a tremendous amount of this organic matter in it, the things that give it that dark black color that we're talking about here. And if we think about putting a garden out or putting an area in a flower bed or anything like that, one of the things we got to think about putting into that is this organic matter. Why do we have to put it in here? Why is it not there anymore? And the reason for that is, as this soil was tilled and it was fluffed up, it allowed this organic part in here to be exposed to the air, and then it just essentially breaks down and goes up into the air, and we lose it. It is carbon. We talk about the carbon cycle. We can talk about the world and how we've got greenhouse gases. One of those greenhouse gases is carbon dioxide. One of the great things about trees is they take all that carbon from the air, they put it into their roots, and as their roots rot away, that carbon then becomes part of the soil, and that's really what makes up organic matter. So you in your garden, if you're going to develop a garden for the first time, want to put that organic matter back into the soil, because generally farming and the practices that we have taken and disturbing the soil has allowed some of this carbon to be blown back up into the air, and we have lost it out of our system. Either that, or the area that we're in, maybe somebody came in there and bulldozed it away and brought up subsoil. Because if we were to go deeper than that foot I was talking about that these tree roots are mostly in, we're going to find soils that are a whole lot worse off and nowhere near as good as far as the organic matter goes, and nowhere near the fertility of thousands and thousands of years of tree leaves that have made up and tree roots that have made up this soil. So in my garden, what I need to do is add organic matter back into it. And so what we're going to talk about next is the types of soils we may find in the garden and how we can add organic matter back into that situation. I come out to this cornfield to demonstrate something we see in gardening also. So many of us take across our soils and just use a rototiller on it and really pulverize the soil tremendously. Well, out here in this farm field, I'm going to take a look at two different things. Across the road here is a field that has been conventionally farmed. In other words, we come out, we chisel plowed it, we disc it, we did all these things where we really messed up the soil. Over here, this soil has had more of a no-till, less tillage applied to it. So across the road, this is what the soil would look like. So let's pick up some soil from across the road where the tillage has gone on, and let's just put this in our hands and see what happens with it. There's one of our friends, the earthworm, there. But this soil, it just crumbles in your hands. There's no structure, as we call it, to that soil. The soil is fairly sandy. It's got some organic matter in it from the blackness. It's probably a pretty good soil, but it just crumbles apart in your hand. It doesn't have that structure. Let's take a look at this soil here. This soil has more structure associated with it. It falls apart in clumps. It has really got the ability to put its roots in here, and the roots are holding it together. This is a whole lot better soil. Where it comes into play in gardening is from the fact that what would really be nice to do is not rototill and pulverize our soil as much as possible, but maybe get the old shovel out there and just do a hand digging, especially if we got a small area, where we put down, we do kind of a double dig, they talk about it, where you dig and kind of break it up like that. And that's one of the ways we can also bring our soils together, is by doing that. And I think that's what you think about when you're dealing with your soils. Try not to pulverize them. Try not to use it too much. Try not to rototill them to death. And I think you'll find you'll have a better soil in your garden and your flower area.